Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship. Let us prepare ourselves for worship. Let us prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. For the scripture says, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised." The scripture says, "Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised." Great is the Lord, saints, and greatly to be praised. Do anyone have a praise this morning? Amen, amen, amen. You know, the book of Psalms is written by numerous authors. In it, it is declared in numerous writings throughout the book that it's not only for our reading, but it's for us to also to acknowledge the Psalms, to meditate on them, and to allow the Holy Spirit to etch them in our hearts for remembrance in times of joy, in times of happiness, also in the times of sadness, but most importantly, to give the Lord God Jesus praise, glory, and honor, acknowledging Him as the one and only true God. It is written, "I will praise thee, O Lord, with my what? Whole heart." That word right there, let's stop at whole, whole. The entire, complete, full, total heart. And as scripture goes on to say, "I will show forth," meaning tell, testify, acknowledge, to speak of, "all thy marvelous works. I will be glad and what? Rejoice in thee." I had here in my notes that Isaiah penned while taking notes for God, in ministering and translating and speaking in his word, 43:21. This people, I'm saying today, this people, you and I, have I formed for myself that they show forth my praise. So we're here once again, another Sunday, for that specific cause. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together, collectively, jointly, as one. Let us give God the glory that is due his name. With a shout, let's magnify him. Because the Lord, as we sing out loud and triumphantly, like that on Palm Sunday, as they took the branches of palm and went forth to meet Jesus, and they cried out, "Hosanna, Hosanna," let us sing, "This is the day." Will you sing, "This is the day"?
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made.
I will rejoice. For this is the day that the Lord has made. I will
rejoice
in it. This is the What has he done?
He has made me glad.
But Hebrews 4 and 7 attributes it to David. And he says, Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Today, if ye will hear his voice. So we have come at the hour of worship. Not just specifically this hour of worship. You know, you can worship any second, any minute, any hour of the day of our being. But right now, we have come to this hour of worship. We come to exalt the Lord our God. We come to worship him at his footstool. For dear Lord, he is kind, he is merciful, he is awesome, all-powerful, ever-present. Someone may know him as myself, as a healer. Amen. Someone may say, he is my good shepherd. We all know he is the Most High God.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
He is the Alpha and Omega. You can add the beginning and the ending. For the Lord God is the creator of all things. It is he who made us and not we ourselves. Someone may cry out to him and know him as strength. Someone else may know him as love. Someone may know him as peace, not forgetting. Someone, or maybe a many in here, may cry out, Lord, you are my rose of Sharon. You are my lily of the valley. Some of us have rendered victories. You know why? Because he was a lawyer in the courtroom. How many of us, as we're driving about, say, Lord, take the wheel? Because he is the wheel in the middle of my will. So again, I'm going to ask you, my brother, and you, my sister, whosoever will, won't you come to the altar? But as we're coming, and as you come, we are remembering, we are recollecting, we are recalling to cast one's mind back as we call upon the Holy Spirit to present itself at this hour and help us establish an atmosphere like no other. Will you come? I need you. Song of conversation to the Lord. Just to say thank you, Lord. Lord, we thank you for our life, our health, and our strength. We are thanking you for how you allowed us to lie down throughout the night, sleep peacefully, waking us up and allowing us to be partakers of another beautiful day which we've never seen before. For that, Father God, we say thank you. Thank you for allowing us to come into once again your house of worship, to praise, to honor, to give you glory. And we ask that you allow your Holy Spirit to come in and sit with us as we create an atmosphere for him to just totally take over this service. Father God, you know our hearts, you know our minds, you know our wants and our needs. Father God, it is thy will, and it has already been asked of your people. Bless them. For any way you bless us, Lord, we will be satisfied. Father God, we ask right now that you touch our shepherd and leader, Bishop Mary E. Jackson. Father God, touch her from the top of her head to the balls of her feet. Fill her up, Father God, with your Holy Spirit. Use her as your tool, Father God, with the things you have spoken to her to give to us, that it penetrate our hearts and our minds, that we look for and that we be changed in every category of our lives. Father God, we ask that you continue to strengthen her. Give her peace of mind. Give her peace of mind, Father God. Blessing her with her family, Father God. You know the situation. Father God, do it right now. And we're thanking you in advance, Father God, for all that you're going to do. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
Done.
he's done. I will bless him. I will bless him for all he's done. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes. Bless his holy name. Yes, yes. Thank you, Lord. Bless his holy name. Amen. 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 Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Good morning, Jerusalem. Amen. Amen. You feel like blessing him now? For all he's done? Amen. 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 We praise God on this morning. At this time, we're asking if everyone would please stand. We're going to read our affirmation of faith. It will be found in your programs and also on our monitors. Amen. And it reads, we believe in the Father who is God Almighty. We believe in the Son, who is Jesus Christ, God's only begotten Son. We believe that Jesus was sent by God to reveal God to man. We believe in the Holy Ghost, who was sent from God, the Father, and the Son. We believe the Bible is the Word of God, given by inspiration through holy men. We believe that the union of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost is revealed through His church. We believe that Christ is coming back for His holy church without spot or wrinkle, that without holiness in spirit, soul, and body, no man shall see the Lord. This is what we believe.
Good morning. Our scripture reading is coming from the 19th chapter of Luke. And the verses selected this morning are 42 through 48. 41 through 48. And when he was come near, he beheld the city and wept over it, saying, if thou hadst known, even thou, at least in this thy day, the things which belong unto thy peace, but now they are hid from thine eyes. For the days shall come upon thee that thine enemies shall cast a trench about thee and compass thee round and keep thee in on every side and shall lay thee even with the ground and thy children within thee. And they shall not leave in thee one stone upon another because thou knewest not the time of thy visitation. And when he went into the temple and began to cast out them that sold therein and them that bought, saying unto them, it is written, my house is the house of prayer, but ye have made it a den of thieves. And he taught daily in the temple, but the chief priests and the scribes and the chief of the people sought to destroy him and could not find what they might do, for all the people were very attentive to hear him. The word of the Lord is blessed.
Good morning, Jerusalem.
Good morning.
Come on, let's honor God. We're here in his presence. And we're in his house, the place of worship that was designed years ago that we might have a place to come in to worship him and to honor him. And so we're grateful for all of those forerunners whom God used to provide means for us to come in and worship him. So let's lay aside all of our concerns and our cares as we're standing here to worship. I tell you, I often think about times I've prayed and I've said, Lord, empty me out so I can be filled again. The things that's not like you, empty them out so that I can be filled. So good morning to you and welcome to Jerusalem. Not only that, all of those who are watching via social media, thank you so much for joining in with us as we came in to honor God and his presence. And so it looked real good to look out on the congregation and see God's beautiful covenant, beautiful and handsome covenant people. You're God's somebody. I just want to tell you that. And I believe this is what God would tell you himself. So we're here to honor him. And certainly to all of our visitors who perhaps are here with us, we give the Lord the fruit of our lips. I know some say, well, you know, it's redundant. Of course it's redundant to remind us what we ought to do in the house of the Lord. And that's at least to give him back something. Amen. So all of us can be blessed. Amen. In reciting our scripture showers that we have chosen to talk to God. There are many, but whatever you've chosen, you can talk to the Lord yourself on your own. And I believe he will receive it. Amen. At this time, your scripture showers. The Lord God have given me the tongue of the learned, that I may know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. He awakeneth morning by morning. He awakeneth mine ear to hear the learned. Isaiah 50:4. We're grateful. And again, we thank God as we're standing. God is so awesome. And we want him to cover us, cover our lives, our homes, our families, even our co-workers, those who we work with. We want God to cover them too. We can pray for them as well. You don't even have to know them to pray for them, for we ought to always pray. So we're getting ready to pray that God would continue to bless you, cover you, keep you, provide for you, and make preparations. He's already made preparations for you on this wonderful Palm Sunday. Wonderful Palm Sunday, where the people were rejoicing about the King. About the King, they were rejoicing. And so we ought to rejoice in the God of our salvation. Let us pray. And you can pray for your neighbor, don't forget. Did everybody speak to each other when they came in? Okay, you're singing beside each other, you're sitting beside each other, you're worshiping beside each other. Did you speak? All right. Let us pray. Father, we love you. Oh my goodness, there's none like you, Master. We honor you in your house, the safest place to be is in the house of the Lord. I know that there are challenges with some houses, but thank you that you continue to provide and keep us in your house. Another time, another moment where some did not get the opportunity to walk in the church this morning. Thank you for those who are home watching via social media as well that can't get here. Bless them. Pray that they will rejoice and that connection will reach them while we praise you on the inside. And so God, again, thank you for every family that's represented here, every family, every generation that's represented here. even those that we possibly haven't reached yet that are here and those that are yet to come. Thank you, Lord. We want to leave a testimony. We want to leave something behind that will let them know that your mother, your father, your grandmother, and your children, however the generations go, that they might know that we love the Lord and we serve the Lord. So we say thank you for this opportunity. Forgive us of sins and or transgressions that we might have sinned against our brothers and our sisters, and receive our prayer. We know that the enemy comes to block our prayers and to make us think you don't hear us, but you hear us. You hear us. You even know our thoughts before we even pray the prayer. So we say thank you. So, Master, today, certainly it's your house. We're the sheep of your pasture. Have your way in this place. Help us to humble ourselves and receive what you have for us individually as well as collectively. So we say thank you, Master. Have your way in this place. We yield. We submit. Cover every home again. Cover, keep, provide, protect, and continue to prepare us for your return. So we say thank you, and we count it done. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Give our next
level ministry. Round of applause. Yes. The announcements are as follows for your hearing. Please also read your announcements at your leisure while you're at home throughout the week. And the announcements for this week of March the 24th reads, a drama presentation of the seven last words of Jesus will be presented on Good Friday, March the 29th at 7 p.m. here at Jerusalem. All the participants who are in the Easter skits, we will rehearse after Sunday morning service today. The youth department is looking forward to the opening of our JUHC park and our annual Easter egg hunt. We are inviting our church family and the community to come out and help us celebrate with fun activities, food, fellowship, and relevant information for our youth and young adults. There will be something special for our adults also. The date is March the 30th, with our hunt starting promptly at 8 a.m. We will have door prizes and beautiful handmade baskets for our Easter hunt winners. Our youth are urged to bring their Bibles for some fun games. Speakers at 1 p.m. will be Centelius Graves, Mark Bowler, Don Johnson in the sanctuary. Brother Eddie Anglero will be the speaker for Fifth Sunday, next Sunday, for morning worship service at 11 a.m., which is Easter Sunday. Now, I was told to put emphasis on this announcement here. The Jerusalem Senior Citizens Trip of 2024 is being planned for June the 26th through the 29th at Lake, what's that word? That's it, that's that place. We have decided to lower the age requirement for our senior trip to 55 years of age. If you are going, and if you are interested in inviting someone else, you may do so. But we need their names and deposits by the time specified. The absolute deadline to sign up is March the 24th, which is today. Is that by midnight or after service? After service. Today. Please sign up ASAP so that you will not miss out on the selected dates. June is the peak season, and we don't want to miss out. Thank you for your cooperation. Sign-up sheets are in the vestibule and in the board in the back. Please contact Sister May Neal or Elder Kim Warrior for more information. A handout is also available. Again, today, everybody say it with me, today is the last day to sign up. The Jerusalem Prayer Conference will be held April the 19th through the 20th of this year. Friday's speaker will be Elder Renee Powell, and music provided by Ronald Thornton and the Sound of Music Chorale. Time of Friday's service is 7 p.m. Saturday presenters will be Elder Danielle Fazen Love, Elder Don Enoch, and Minister Valencia Elderson Clark. Workshops begin at 9 a.m. promptly. Prayer service is 12 noon. Registration is $25 and lunch will be provided. Also, you may see Sister Donna Graves or Hazel Williams if you would like to register today or anytime after today for the prayer conference. In relation to the Western North Carolina District and a general church, Bishop Harry L. Coyne will be honored at a gala celebration during the upcoming general convocation on Saturday, May the 4th. Tickets are available on the United Holy Church of America website, as well as check money order for the donation of $125. Please make checks payable to the United Holy Church of America, P.O. Box 2923, Burlington, North Carolina, 21216. At 7 p.m., you may also contact Sister Irene Kors. I was getting ahead of myself. The United Holy Church of America Incorporated General Mass Choir of North Carolina, Virginia, and South Carolina regions has a rehearsal scheduled that will be at New Covenant United Holy Church, 1258 Apple Street in Burlington, North Carolina, at 7 p.m. on the following dates, which is April the 12th and April the 26th. Application for the ministerial license are being taken by the Board of Presbytery. The application must be submitted by June the 1st, which is the date of a Western North Carolina District meeting. You may contact Elder David Henderson at 336-932-2701 or email dhenderson2023@frontier.com or Reverend Dr. Gloria Ogugu at 919-401-0687 or the email ogugu2000@hotmail.com. As it relates to community, the Ministerial Alliance of Reedsville and vicinity would like to extend to you a personal invitation to attend our annual citywide revival. This year, we will have an in-person and virtual revival April the 2nd through April the 4th, 7 p.m. nightly at Zion Baptist Church at 807 Piedmont Street here in Reedsville, North Carolina. Reverend Dr. Greg T. Hedden serves as the interim pastor. The evangelist for the week for our City Ride Revival is the Elder Laney Robinson, pastor of Monument of Faith Ministries in Eden, North Carolina. Special music will be provided nightly. Wednesday night will be recognized as Youth Night. We ask that you encourage your youth to be part of this service in person or virtually. Holy Trinity Tabernacle will be celebrating and praising God as they observe the installation service of their pastor, Yvonne D. Ellison on this afternoon at 2:30 p.m. The speaker will be Bishop L. Bernard Florence and the St. Thomas Chapel Pentecostal Holiness Church of Greensboro, North Carolina. Now, I have only one card. At this time, we want to recognize any visitors, Dolly and Donald Smalley. If you all will please stand. Okay, we can do better than that in recognizing and welcome our visitors. Are there any other visitors? Mrs. Smalley, would you like to have a few words? Would you please remain standing? Please remain standing. We have a little token of our love towards you. But thank you for coming to Jerusalem. Please stand.
You can go and sing it.
I'm going to stand. I'm going to stand in my lane.
Welcome to Jerusalem. We are so glad you came. This is where you hear the word and sinners can be changed. Yes, we love to praise the Lord and lift His holy name. You can clap your hands, stomp your feet, join us in a song, singing loud and strong. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, and let Him have His way. We appreciate you coming to join in with us on today. God bless you. Prayerfully, you will enjoy yourself. When you're not busy at your church, you're welcome to come and worship with us. God bless you. Enjoy.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Did y'all hear what Pastor said? She said, you can go ahead and lead the song. I know how to stay in my lane. There's one other announcement that I failed to mention, and it reads, the president, faculty, and board of trustees of Living Epistle Bible College 2.0 proudly announces the graduation of the class of 2024. It's going to be on Saturday, the 4th of May, 2024, at 10 o'clock a.m., commencement services will be held at St. Thomas Chapel Pentecostal Holiness Church, 633 Highway 150 East in Greensboro, North Carolina. And also I have a card to read, and it states, we're so thankful to have friends like you. Every smile you brought to our hearts, every wise word of encouragement you shared, every time you've been there for us when we needed you the most, makes us even more grateful for the gift of your love and your friendship in our lives. This is from the families of the Courts, Massey, and the Cardwell family. Well, as our presider, which is chilling in the back, often says, it is offering time.
No.
Those of you that give by Cash App, Givelify, the information will be on the screen. Also to our visitors, if you would like to share in our offering, the information is there for you as well. As we pray for our offering afterwards, the usher will come down and serve those that are giving in their offering. Precious Father, again, we come to you to say thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father God, for this time of offering where we come to give what you have given back to us, Father God. We ask that you bless this offering, Father God. Use it for the upkeep of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. just came my way, picked me up and he turned me around, and he placed my feet on higher ground. Said it was love. Said it was love. I know it was love.
Let's give this pit crew a round of applause. And the choir. I tell you, if you don't move, I don't know. They'll make you move. Your bones might be a little stiff, Bishop, but it'll make you move your bones. God is good, and we give him the glory. Certainly, we are glad for this wonderful day called Palm Sunday. And although in the history of the scriptures, this day starts wonderfully when it came to Jesus Christ. But this also precedes a week of trials and tribulations, ultimately leading to the cross for Christ. We've been talking about a few lessons concerning Calvary. or his route to Calvary, and how he was challenged on his way to Calvary through the scriptures. How many of you know that you're going to have challenges on this road? Yeah, you're going to have challenges. But when you're anchored in the Lord enough, you know who helps you and carry you through the challenges. And as a matter of fact, I want to remind you that you will always have challenges. So when they come, be ready to remain faithful and committed to what God has promised you. So out of this 19th chapter of Luke, powerful lesson, but those few scriptures that were read in your hearing were very powerful to me. And actually it gives information about Christ preparing himself to go into the city that he loves very dearly and the people that he loved very dearly. And so please allow me, if you will, to read that 41st verse again, King James Version. And when he was come near, in other words, as he was approaching Jerusalem, how many of you know the nearer you get to a situation or a place, you can see it better? So as he's coming near to Jerusalem, he beheld the city. So when he was a distance away, he could see, but as he approached, now he can see the state of Jerusalem even better. And the Bible says that he wept. He wept over, can I just add, the condition that Jerusalem was in. And you know, this weeping that he wept was just not, this weeping was a burst. He burst into tears. Oh! He burst into tears. And it says that he wept out loud. He sobbed. He wailed. He mourned. He was literally heartbroken because of what he saw. So when you look at the text, you will see that he was quite concerned at the state because of what had happened down through time concerning his coming to Jerusalem. But he was also weeping because he loved Jerusalem. And he loved Jerusalem down through time. And so he wept profusely, if you would allow me. So the Bible says previously in the text that he gave the disciples instructions to send for a donkey, okay? The other writers say an ass and a colt. And I'm not cursing young people. So different writers, but still they're in the same realm of, he sent for this colt, and even one writer said a colt and an ass. So, I mean, you know, this is what they wrote. And so he says to them, tell the owner to send a colt that has never been ridden before, especially for a lot of normal. Send me one that no one has ever ridden on before. Because it was something about riding on a donkey, can I say, that hadn't been used, that had something to do with a royal entrance. And so therefore, they obeyed what Jesus said. And the Bible said he received that donkey or the animal. And the Bible says that those disciples took their cloaks and spread it on the animal so the seat would be comfortable for Jesus on the mule. And so at this time, while they are making preparations for him to go into Jerusalem, the Bible says that there was a crowd that continued to follow him, but the crowd continued to number higher. In other words, it was a lot of people that were already following Jesus at that time. So you can imagine what those individuals saw when they were approaching Jerusalem. And the Bible doesn't, is not clear on whether Jerusalem or the individuals per se looked out and saw Jesus and the other was following. It tells us that he was making preparations to go in. And as I've often stated, it was traditional that if a leader rode in on a horse, that meant he was coming in for fighting, or it was not a peaceful ride if he comes in on a horse. But when he came in on a meek, lowly animal, then he's coming in for peace. He's coming in for peace. And so I want to use for a thought on this morning the rejection of the peace giver, the rejection of the Prince of Peace. Let us pray, Father. It is not I, but it's the Christ. Speak through this earthen vessel, this vessel that is not qualified, but you're the one that qualifies a person to speak on your behalf. And so we say thank you. We count it done in Jesus' name. Rejection. If I ask everybody to raise their hand, most of us probably would raise our hand to the fact that at some point in our lives, we felt rejection in diverse ways. We felt rejection for so many different reasons. And so when you look at rejection, it means refuse to accept, consider, or even to submit to. That's one definition. Listen to the word. Refuse to accept, consider, or to even submit to. The next meaning is refuse to hear, refuse to receive, or even refuse to admit. So those are two different perspectives of rejection. And really, both is applicable to Jesus as he's approaching Jerusalem and once he really gets into Jerusalem. I was doing some study in Deacon Davis, and it was showing me that, and some of us might know this writer, Wilmington's Guide to the Bible. He said that there were 72 steps that Jesus took on his journey to the cross. But in the studies, and I'm not trying, you know, I just want to, do you mind if I just give you a little bit of the history? You mind? And so it says that in all those steps, Deacon Penix, there were all these subcategories of all the things that he said, he did, the places he went. You have good information about that, especially some of the preachers who have to give messages on Easter Sunday or whatever. And so he has a lot of information about those steps and the subcategories of predictions, subcategories of healing people, subcategories of opening eyes, subcategories. All of that is in the studies. But at this particular time, we are at step 51. So he had already had many steps that he had achieved already. And remember those years of obscurity that he already had. Now he shows up at the age of 30. So here he is after all the work and all the marvelous things he had done for people, redeemed them. And there were times he did have to chastise and rebuke, but still, there were even times that individuals tried to stop his journey to the cross. We talked about that. But he pursued. The Bible says once he gets to Jerusalem and all of the things are prepared for him, he had compassion. But if you read the text a little further, you will see he had anger. Because look where he goes in that step. He goes to the temple. And they were not doing the things that they should have done in the temple. You know, the Bible says that judgment is going to begin in the house of the Lord. And you ask yourself sometimes, why does he say that? Why does the scripture say that? Because we are to know the rules, the regulations, the commandments, the statutes of God, and we are supposed to know them enough to not reject them and try to appease ourselves with our own interpretation of them. And so therefore, he enters into the city grieved, and he began to talk to them and tell them some things about themselves and some things they had to deal with. Yes, he came to bring peace, but right away you had those Pharisees that were watching and watching the crowd follow him to Jerusalem. They were upset, and as a matter of fact, in that step, they were preparing to see how they could destroy him. And if you go back just a little further, you read that they were upset when he raised Lazarus up from the dead. They didn't like that because people were changed just by watching the resurrection of Lazarus. So people were coming to Christ, and they were influenced by Christ. How many of you know with Christ in your life, you're very influential to others because of the Christ, not because of you. It's because of the Christ. So they wanted to kill him and Lazarus again. They wanted to kill Lazarus after the Lord raised him up from the dead. Why did they think that they could kill him and get by with it? But that's how it is when people are set in their ways, want to do their own thing, and they believe in what they believe in. Yeah, they're determined that they're right about things. And that's what they did. So there came a time when Jesus had to wipe the tears away and deal with the matters at hand. And he had to make sure that they understood. They were angry when he went into the temple. And of course, as this week goes on, you can read the steps that he had to go through. Every day it was something. No matter how nice he was, there was always these challenges that would try to prevent him from getting to the cross. Read them sometimes. How many of you dust and trust your Bible and don't read it? Read it. because it will give you instructions. You need it. Yeah. So the Bible says that he had already told them of some predictions. And when you look at, again, the time, and you look at the history of what God tried to do at this time, this is it now. He tells them, you will see destruction. Because down through time, let's look at the history. Go back to Genesis. I've been saying this for weeks. Go back to Genesis. He'd been speaking to the children of Israel down through time. He had been blessing them down through time. He had been delivering them down through time. He had been delivering them and delivering them and delivering them. And then he would deliver them and still they would go back to doing things that were not permissible. And at this time, remember, he is setting the stage for a revolutionary time for history. Because now we move from the old covenant to the new covenant. And when I say move from, we still keep the old covenant in the sense of its knowledge. But then the new covenant is going to fulfill what the old taught us. And so they had violated. As a matter of fact, there were people that were from all parts of the world that came for this feast. We know the feast of Passover, because they were commanded to celebrate the feast so that they could remember from whence they came. And we know that, you know, the feast of the Passover was once a year. Atonement was once a year. So, you know, Jesus atoned for the people, but you know, in a year's time, people seem to forget what they heard, what they saw. And so this was a time of celebration, celebrating and being reminded of from where they came from. They came from a point when they were going to be destroyed by the enemy, by Pharaoh. But the Bible says he told those that understood the dynamics of the blood, put the blood on the doorpost. Put it on the doorpost. And when I see the blood, when I send the problem, when I send the plagues, I will pass over you. I will pass over you. That's what I will do. And so he sees the condition of Jerusalem. Many things are going on. It was a generational problem. A generational problem. How many of you know we have generational problems? It's a generational problem. And God just wanted to send his son to straighten it out. So let's look at this a moment here. There are three different types of peace we could talk about. And Jesus was the peace giver. There is a peace with God. In other words, there is a peace when he's with you that surpasses all understanding. He promised that. And why some of us don't panic in the midst of trials, tribulations, because he promised us peace, so that peace with God and how he operates and how he manifests himself, we're at peace with that. Even though we might be challenged, we have enough peace, trust, and faith to know that he's going to bring us out all right. I listened to my sister make such a powerful testimony this morning on Sunday school. Don't you know God said, I am the Lord God that healeth thee? That nothing is too hard for me. We make it hard for him to do what he wants to do for us. We make it hard. So when I listened to the reports of healing and prayer that went forth, the fervent effectual prayers of the righteous availeth much. That's what the word said. And so having that peace with God, what he does, how he does it, when he wants to do it, trusting him that it's going to be all right. And then there's the peace of God. Again, the peace of God that surpasseth all understanding. And so that peace of God gives us what we need internally as well as externally. He gives us what we need. The peace of God that passes all understanding. I think I shared this with you before. One of my sisters in Christ, this is when I lived in New York. And, you know, we go to funerals and we would go to places and, you know, whatever. And, you know, I'm talking about the funerals where people were falling out and doing all those kind of things. So she said to me one day, she said, "Do you ever cry?" I said, "Yes, I do. Yeah, I do." She wondered why I never cried. And she didn't see me cry. And so, you know, it's not that, it's just that he conditions you, because the peace of God conditions you to handle it. And I'm not saying we shouldn't cry, because I will cry. And when I was reading the lesson, I wept. Because the passion, I can only speak for the passion of a pastor. You know, and I know we have Bishop Williams and perhaps others that are, you know, in leadership roles as well. And when Jesus works down through time to make it right for his people, and when pastors work hard, labor and pray and whatever is needed, try to help, it can be grievous and it can cause you to weep when you see the choices go another way that they make. Oh yeah, that's the truth. That's the truth. And so although we pray, and then sometimes the choices that are made are detrimental, one, and then two, it can really cause permanent damage if we're not careful, especially if we don't know the Lord. So the peace of God. And then, of course, the peace from God. So he sends his son to give us peace, because now he's on his way. He's on his way to alter everything for us. We can't keep the law, and he knew it. So he says, I need to fix it so that the law will be fulfilled and they will trust my son. And the power that he gives them by the Holy Spirit. By the Holy Spirit that abides. But unfortunately, they made their own decision. So the Bible says that ultimately the word went out. And of course, you can search the history and you will see that his word was true. Because in 70 AD, Jerusalem was destroyed. What are you talking about, Pastor, today? What are you trying to relate to us? It's a dangerous thing to reject the Prince of Peace. I'm not even going to fight with you about your lifestyles. Do what you want. I need to preach it. I need to preach it. Because Deacon Penix, the wrong decisions can get you in a lot of trouble. I'm going to say this. Can I come down? I'm going to say this, and this is the first time I've ever breathed this to anyone. And, you know, I'm going to be transparent. Y'all can deal with it or not. You know what I'm saying? Deal with it. I remember a time in my life when I was saved and loved the Lord and just rambunctious and just anxious, and I might have shared some of this. Just anxious, just going out trying to bring everybody to church. Sister Mamie just doing everything, or whatever. Yeah. Until things started happening to discourage me because I thought I was right. Bringing folk to the church, trying to get them saved. You know, drunks, alcoholics. I didn't care what people said about me. I just needed to get them to the church.
Yes.
It was nothing. It was nothing for me to take my little car. I had a small car, a little used car. I couldn't buy a new one. I had a used car, and I would pack it full of alcoholics and drug addicts. And I would bring them to church because before I understood evangelism, God was using me in evangelism. And I would bring them to church. And then, sis, when I saw some of the things that seemed to be displeasure to the church that I thought was right to do, I got discouraged. I got discouraged. And like I said, I want you to hear this. If you want to talk about it to me. And don't come to your own conclusions when you go out and meet your friends and whoever. Okay? I remember I got discouraged. And I won't go through all of the things that happened from believers. The things they were doing. Their behaviors. By not being raised in church, I did not expect it. I expected the niceness. I expected all of that. I really did. I really did. And I got discouraged. I got saved at 19. And I remember I was doing well, and I remember they talked about fasting. I didn't even understand the dynamics of fasting. They didn't explain it to me. I went on a 40-day fast. This was a total fast, and almost killed myself as a new convert. Almost killed myself. And then afterwards, they said to me, oh, you weren't supposed to do that. And here I am with my knees buckled and almost couldn't make it. And I was saying, Lord, is it me? Do I not have the faith? Do I not have enough belief? You know, you start second-guessing yourself. I thought I did it right. But that's what happens when you don't have good instructions. That's why all of our leaders in this church should give good instructions and make sure they're clear. And then leave the choices up to the people. Whether they want to do right or wrong. And so I remember I got so despondent. And I was really curious about salvation. I was curious about God. I was curious about all these things. And I was ready to go out and, you know, and again save the world. You know, and they said, you can't go because you got a running devil. They said I had a running devil. I said, what is a running devil? See the language? And I'm really teaching something because we got to watch our language when we're dealing with people that are unsaved. He said, I said, what is a running? And see, I wasn't being sarcastic. I was being for real. What is a running devil? And I'm trying to run the church. You know. And so anyway, what ultimately happened, I got discouraged. And I just said, well, what's the use? Because if the church is not right, where can I go? And in our workshop yesterday, this lady touched on it, the presenter touched on it real good. When they can't find what they're supposed to get in church, they go somewhere else. And she gave that illustration of a young guy who came to the church, and he was not received. And he said, okay. I think he wanted to be baptized. He wanted to be, and they told him he was too young. And so what he did, he went out and joined a gang. And the gang received him. And so what happened again, you know, I decided that I was going to do my thing. I was independent anyway, and I had children already for the young girls and whatever. God can forgive you for that. Because, you know, you fall in love and you think they love you and they don't love you. Come on, let's talk. And I'm going to take my seat. You fall in love and, you know, they promise they're going to bring you the world and they don't bring you nothing but heartache and pain. Yeah, young, innocent, and not knowing, naive. You believe it. You believe it. Then they claim they're going to marry you. They don't marry you. They don't marry you. So I just said, okay, well, forget it. I don't need to go to church then. But what I started doing, here's how I backslid. I backslid by not going to that church and going to other churches just to sit and just to observe what they were doing and other denominations. And then what happened, somebody caught my eye. He knew I was a church girl. And you know what they say about the guys in the world? You want a girl, go to church and get her. Oh yeah, I'm talking. Go to church and get her. She don't know all though. Go get her. Because she need a man. She needs somebody. Yeah. So someone caught my eye. Nice looking. Handsome. Tall. And I was so desperate for love. I couldn't get it from the church. And didn't know that he didn't love me. I just wanted him to love me. And I even said to him, you don't have to love me. I have enough love for both of us. Don't you believe that? Don't you believe that? Just because you have an overabundance of love doesn't mean that they have the same love for you. Pastor, you're not preaching. You talk about your life. I am, because it's a part of the message. And so what ultimately happened, I almost lost my life from a beating that I got. I almost lost my life. And so it's interesting how the word, when it gets in you and, you know, it has a chance to really get on some good ground. You know, it's interesting how the word of the Lord comes back to remind you. I love you with an everlasting love.
Yes, he does. God does.
And so I was thinking, how could you love me? Because of what I did. My love is not like other people's love. It's not like other people's love. So he worked with me. Changed my life. And guess what I learned? Not to backslide again. Because I think the next time it would have killed me. And let me just say this. They know you're saved. They know you love the Lord. But they also see those spots or those things that you need and pray, P-R-E-Y, upon them. And make you think you don't have nobody but them. Who else gonna want you with children? That's what they say to you. Well, maybe they didn't say that to you. I'm just saying it was said to me. Yeah, it was said to me. Who else gonna want you but me? Why am I saying this? Because I think our young girls need to hear this. Because sometimes they don't like it at home. They don't like what they see at home. They don't like the behavior at home. They don't like it because mommy and daddy is arguing. Everybody's fighting and fussing and carrying on. And they don't want to stay home. And Johnny's just waiting on the corner to get them. Yeah. And then he listens to your story. And says, I gotta. Why am I doing this? Jesus, down through generations, wooed Israel, loved on them,
yes,
and kept redeeming them from situations. How many times does he have to redeem us from situations that we keep getting ourselves into? And then we have the nerve to blame God for it. I knew not to blame God for my own decision. I had to plead to help me to get out of it. Because when your heart gets in it, it's hard to move your body out of it.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. His heart was in Israel, wanting them to change. And he distinctly told them, this is it now. I've got to redeem you because you don't even have enough sense. I'm talking about me. You don't even have enough sense. To make the right decisions for yourself. And so I'm saying, in the applications, I have them. There are no excuses for rejecting Christ. No excuses now. This is a different world, different dispensation now. Then they didn't have the Bibles. They didn't have the things. They had the scrolls and they had the priests. They had annual meetings, and now you have service all the time, everywhere, any place you want to go. In whatever town, you have so much of the word that is out here that you can get the word however you need it. And so he says, that's it. I've got to do this. I've got to get to the cross.
Yes, yes.
And I've got to redeem Mary Jackson.
Got to redeem
Mary. Because she'll die from foolishness. That's what she'll do.
Yes.
And number two, no worldly situations, items will be able to suffice when it comes to Christ.
That's right. Amen.
You know, it just doesn't suffice.
No, it doesn't.
Tell your story about me again and then I'm going to sit down. I remember years ago, Sister Mamie, I was in New York and I wanted a fur coat. I didn't have no money. They didn't even give women credit. So I had a friend of mine, she dressed nice all the time, and she was an older woman. I've always been around older women for the most part. And she dressed nice, and we went in the store one day, and I said, I sure would love that fur. So she helped me get the fur. But guess what? Over time, it started losing the validity of it. I got so excited, I went and bought me a coat too. I went and bought me a coat, sis. And guess what? It came apart at the seams. It came apart at the seams. And God has had to teach me lessons. I don't know about you. I thought I was cute in my little mink coat. You know, I could look good if I didn't feel good. How about that? I could look good if I didn't feel good. Some of us look good, but we don't feel too good. Yeah, 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 yeah. And so what I did, Deacon David, I had a girl. I said, I can't lose this coat. Make me a pocketbook. Make me a pocketbook with this meat. I paid too much money for this meat. You know, so I'm just telling you how ridiculous we can get at times because we don't have much. We want to keep what we got. Of course, even the pocketbook decided to. Sister Judy, the pocketbook started to say, I'm sick of you, Mary Jackson. I'm tired. I'm just saying, and then the third and the last. I know it sounds a little, but God is kind of changing me and changing the way I deal with things in terms of ministry. And then number three, no exceptions, only Christ. No exceptions to the rule. You got to do what he said. But it's not hard, for the Bible says the ways of a transgressor is hard. Yes, you have challenges and whatever, but when it gets hard, somewhere along the line, you're mixing your own theories and your own decisions and your own ideas in it, and it gets hard that way. And sometimes it means denying yourself of what you'd like to have, because sometimes what you'd like to have is not good for you. And so, are you here today and you're saying, I can't find it in the church. I can't find it in the world. I can't find it wherever I go. You need to find it in Jesus. Amen. That's where it needs to be, in the Lord. And he'll help you with the rest of it. And you might say, well, that's because you're old now. No, 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 I was young. I once was young. Oh, let me say this, younger. Younger. Because people keep trying to tell me, you old. And I remember one of my grandsons that I hadn't seen in a few years. I met him in Maryland and he looked at me and he said, you're not old like they said you was. And I started to say to him, who told you I was old? So children will tell you the truth. They'll tell you the truth. They rejected him. Don't reject him. Accept him. And you'll see how he will change your life. As our musicians play softly. While Jesus had prepared himself for that week of horror. For generations, and then now we're in a generation where we're receiving the benefits. We're receiving the benefits. Yes, we are. I remember one time I was witnessing to a young girl and she said to me, it's another sister in Christ, young sister in Christ. I was talking to her about a situation in her own life. And she said to me, well, you learned, let me learn for myself. I said, okay. It's between you and God now. And I won't tell you the rest of what happened to her life because it wasn't good. And so are you here and you're tossed? It's just time to line up with God's will. That's what the man told us. I didn't deserve his goodness, but he himself made something good out of my life. And if you would like to come for prayer, we'll pray with you. You will have to ultimately make the decision of receiving Christ, or if you have him and you know that you're contrary to his will, then that's your choice. So as they play, are you here? Are you here? Would you like prayer? Lord, I haven't done everything right. But you're the God that corrects the wrong in our lives. And certainly we don't want to reject the peace giver, the Prince of Peace. Would you like prayer? Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, thank you, Lord. Thank you. And I'm going to ask, bless you, bless you. The mask. In a drawer. Yes. I still need prayer. Yes. It's not in a drawer. Okay. All right. In a drawer. Yes. Yeah, sing something. Yeah. Yes. So while you're sitting there in the seat, I have one. Yes. 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 Yes, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Master. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All right, we are here with various requests from the Lord. We don't reject His word. We try to live as best as we know how, upright, do what is right. But there are challenges that happen to us. There are challenges. But there's a difference when you have challenges. Amen. You're not doing what you're supposed to do. So for those who have come, you know exactly what you came for. And we're going to pray. He died that we would receive every promise that he gave to us. Every promise. It belongs to you. It belongs to me. And no one can take that away. Let us pray. Father, we do love you and we honor you. Thank you, Master. Thank you for your love, your kindness, your mercy. Thank you for those that are on the altar. Various situations, whether it be trouble in the heart, the mind, in the body, you've given us a word to know that I can do all things for you as long as you understand my love for you, and I can do it for you. And so therefore, we can accomplish through the word of God. So God, everyone that's on the altar, thank you in advance. Show forth your glory in their lives. And just as that anointing flowed down Aaron's ear, let the anointing flow to resolve the issues, to resolve, bring closure to issues. So God, we thank you again for each one, even those that are in their seats. Bless them, Lord, and keep them. Give good directions that they may follow them. We say thank you, Minister, and we count it done in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Can we give the Lord praise? Do you really, really believe our prayers? Do we really believe our prayers can be answered? Amen. You may be seated. God bless you. all to stand. Again, we thank God for our next level of ministry and our young people, our ushers, tech crew, pit crew. We thank God for you, choir. Thank God for you. And certainly it's been a wonderful day and a wonderful fellowship. And even those who are watching, always remember that you can always come to the Lord and receive salvation. Just confess your sins, stop doing it, and then let him do the rest of the work. Amen. So we're getting ready to go. All right, encourage someone, tell them, do not reject the Prince of Peace. And now to him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we could ever ask or think, according to the power that worketh within us, to the only majestic, wonderful, dynamic God, be dominion, majesty, and power forever. Let us all sing together. Amen. Go in peace. Greet someone you don't know. Yes. Thank you, choir. Thank you. Bless you.